Welcome back from the break. If you look at the scoreboards right now, the Sherdils are at 6 and the Crusaders have made a crazy comeback and they are right now at 5. We move on to the decider of the match. Dota 2 by Valve Corporation.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Ucypher Season 1. My name is Vivek, with me is CloudX, and you're watching the Crusaders on the Radiant face off versus the Sherdils on the Dire. Sherdils do have what many would consider the top players in the Indian Pro Circuit.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Ucypher League. Nasport,
the Nasport,
and we certainly have one of them on the side of the Crusaders. It's Invincible for me. But can Invincible, minus the experience, age and wisdom of Remstar, be enough to ensure that Crusaders get a victory versus the Sherdils? The Sherdils, they did manage to win the game of Counter-Strike earlier on versus the Crusaders. They're sitting at 14 points, while the Crusaders, they're 10, if I'm not mistaken.
There is a certain benefit in having Remstar sit out for this particular game up as well. The fact is, every now and then you do need someone standing behind to analyze what the situation is. Now, I want to go out on a limb here and say that Crusaders feels confident about winning this particular matchup. It could be the reason why you have Remstar sitting back, just to simply analyze what's going right and what's going wrong with the rest of his teammates to come back stronger. This may be construed as a sign of disrespect by Sherdils, which should be additional motivation for them to come back strong into this particular matchup.
Yeah.
But we do have the draft getting underway. Nightstalker and Batrider have been banned out from the pool. Standard stuff.
Yeah, pretty standard.
5 seconds
What's
remaining.
Also worth noting is that the player who sits out can stand behind the players. Behind the players that are playing, this is much like how Dota 2 is currently played internationally, where you have a coach who supervises his team during the draft to some extent. And Atul's going to step back and take a look at the draft itself. Darshan will be pulling the draft through for the Crusaders. Atul or Remstar right behind them, guiding them with all his experience over the numerous
hours that he spent playing Dota.
And what does that result in? An opening pick, Earthshaker. One of the most favored heroes in Ucypher, along with the Earth Spirit. I mean, the green heroes are there as well, but Earthshaker gets a lot of love.
Yeah, I mean, Earthshaker is one of those heroes, Joe Carter is the execution giving. He doesn't really require a high skill floor. At the worst case, you can always drop a Fisher from long range, you can jump in with the multiple stuns. It's a different ball game relying on your Earthshaker as your only source of AoE magic damage, but I highly doubt Crusaders will go in that direction.
You
might
see
something like a Disruptor to join this Earthshaker, maybe a Nyx Assassin, a Rubik to deal with that Nyx Assassin in the low cast point. Lots of options for them. I like the Nyx opening pick from Sherdils though. This is a hero that's received much less love than he should at Ucypher League.
Yeah. The Sherdils have also done a fair bit of research. They banned out the Lich and Sengen. Did play a phenomenal Lich for the Crusaders. You said this could be a sign of confidence coming out from Remstar that he's sitting this one out. But actually, Sherdils are one of the stronger teams in the tournament. They've got a bunch of active players, all of them in the peak of their farm. Khans is an excellent offlaner. Mamacita is good in the mid role. Disruption, Opa, Rival, all active and all really playing with a sense of flow and ease that you don't see too often in the Indian Dota 2 scene.
I don't even think it's fair to call them youngsters anymore, man. While they may be young in age, they've attended so many lands of late. In fact, just recently, I believe we saw Mamacita on the main stage elsewhere as well. So they've come into this tournament completely armed and ready. And I mean, if Crusaders were ever going to have a run for their money versus Sherdils, it's going to be in this particular game.
The Dire!
But the interesting storyline so far has been the Marksman. We've seen everyone vying to get enough points to catch up with the Marksman, and who knows, this particular match could give Crusaders a shot in that direction.
Yeah, Crusaders are sitting at 10 points. If they do end up winning this, they'll be at 15, which is going to cement their lead.
10 seconds.
I mean, they're going to be third place. But the Marksmen are sitting at 25
seconds
points,
remaining.
If I'm not mistaken. And
Radiant's turn to ban.
Yeah, they're sitting at 26 points.
Dire's
they have a strong lead
now
that they're working with. But yeah, the fight for second, third, fourth is between the rest of the teams. And Crusaders, if they do end up winning this, they could move up in the table.
What's interesting is they've started off with the Silencer as the second pick. Silencer, Earthshaker, not a big fan of this duo. I think it's fairly greedy, especially if that's going to be a four position Earthshaker. If it's
seconds.
Three, maybe it's slightly different.
Yeah.
Silencer as a five is very situational.
5 seconds remaining.
I don't think he's really good versus the Nyx because of the way Silencer scales. For those of you new viewers out there, you should know that Silencer is one of those heroes that gets stronger with every kill he stays in the area of. It's the equivalent of basically getting smarter every time you kill, and you learn as you move on. The fact that the Nyx Assassin hurts you based on how much mana you're possessing, and mana is a factor of intelligence, makes the Nyx a really good counter to the Silencer on some level. Crusaders, I don't know if they've done their homework on picking this next pickup up, but I'm sure they have something in mind, something that synergizes with the Silencer. I'm thinking of possibly a Sand King.
I'm thinking the same, because Tashin played the Sand King last time around, and I sense that Darshan might want to pick the Sand King off himself. There is a certain ease of execution. Burst Strike at the center, Global Silence. It could result in one kill. It should result in two. Ideally, you should open with a two-hero Burst Strike. That's when this duo starts to make some sense.
Here's the Radiant but the Ban.
Another worry factor for Sherdils is that Shadow Shaman. It's such a hit and a miss pick, because while he's good at pushing buildings and does bring control to the fights, he's squishy. I mean, Earthshaker or, you know, anyone for that matter just Dyer's picks up a Patthar and throws it on his head, he's gonna die on the battlefield. There's not too much he can do if he's focused. And, you know, with a Nyx Assassin as your secondary support, it's not like that's a hero that comes in and disrupts the team fight by himself. Yeah. Nyx is one of those sneaky, beaky-like heroes that goes in from behind, tries to start the fight when no one's looking, tries to get some damage done if no one's keeping him, well, no one's controlling him in the fights, but... You know, Shadow Shaman dies in seconds, and it's not like he's going to get a PKB or an early kills either, because he's position 5. Silencer will rip him apart in the Global Silence. What's the game plan for Sherdils? Do you think they just go all in and push with the Pugna, maybe?
Yeah, the Pugna wouldn't be too bad. Offlane Pugna, I'm not entirely a fan of, but maybe mid or safely. I see, offlane Pugna can work. Red got really lucky in one of the earlier games, but I don't think that's going to be the case every time. If you just apply a little bit of pressure early on, it's very easy to bring down a Pugna. But yeah, I am a fan of the Pugna, and if the Sherdils do not pick it up, Crusaders might end up picking it up themselves. Now, this is a conundrum for most teams, because this is when they're considering a green hero to choose from. Which green hero do we choose? Two of them have been banned out.
But two still remain, and neither have been picked just yet. The Doom pickup from Sherdils, I don't know if it's supposed to scare Crusaders from picking up a Necrophos or a green hero for themselves, but...
10 seconds.
I mean, if I'm in the driver's seat for Crusaders, I still go with that.
5 seconds remaining.
I think the Shadow Shaman, he's already got enough to worry about. You throw the Pugna into the mix and, you know, he's been relegated to the fountain. He just sits there and just, you know, holds his head in his hands and contemplates life.
Yeah.
Crusaders can go for a push of their own. They might be met with some resistance courtesy of the Doom. He's really Dyer's efficient in the mid-game stage when you want to beat a
Legion Commander!
What?
Huh. Okay. Dual Global Silence. That's what they're hoping to do.
In the later stages, that makes some sense, but when the LC is too weak to take down a target by itself, I'm not a fan of this. Is this indicative of an armlet first Legion Commander? No Blink Dagger, just get some bonus damage to start with, then use that Global Silence to rack up the money for the Blink? That could work, but it's such a risky way to approach the game.
Yeah, it could work, and... it's going to boil down to whether Legion has a decent start in lane and even gets that armlet in the first place. Right now, there are a good amount of support to really contest the Legion. And the Swen with the Warcry and the Cleave, it's going to be really difficult for Legion to approach the wave even sometimes. Especially once the Swen gets a couple of levels. There's overwhelming odds, they're only going to tickle. And if you come into lane with a fair amount of consumables, life just gets harder and harder for the Legion Commander, and I presume she'll be retreating back into a jungle early on. Next up for the Crusaders, two green heroes still in the pool. Actually, one, right? It's the Pugna as well as the Necrophos.
They're both in the pool right now, and there's still very viable options for either side. Crusaders, I get the vibe that they're going for the Invoke in this game. It's got a good amount of synergy with the Legion Commander, and that could be... Legion is the incentive to pick up that Invoker. I'm pretty certain Invincible plays the Invoker on the middle lane as well, so...
It is...
That kid's been styling over all of his opponents, and what better way to style some more than with an Invoker pickup, right?
I agree, it's a good game for the Invoker. I just hope that the Crusaders don't pick it up straight away right now.
I actually think they should, because picking the Invoker, banning the Pugna, and then moving in to watch what Sherdils has last should work for them.
Okay.
The primary threat for the Invoker right now is the Nyx Assassin.
If he gets doomed, I think he's okay with it.
He just backs away and
lets his team take care of matters for him. But no, they'll go with the Phantom Assassin.
And I am left scratching my head at this draft.
Coming up from the Crusaders? Yeah. I think they're holding on to the Invoker till the very end. I mean, that's the feeling I get. I'd like to see Crusaders make a small adjustment here and somehow try and fit the Winter Wyvern into their lineup. The Cold Embrace is good versus what's primarily physical damage. Nobody's going to be able to. Nobody's going to be brought down in the duel. The Winter's Curse is also really good versus the Phantom Assassin and the Legion Commander. But right now, there isn't really space for the Winter Wyvern. Anyhow, Crusaders, this is their turn to pick up the Invoker if it is indeed what they're looking for.
They did ban the Lina, though. That could be indicative of the Phantom Assassin going mid, in which case they should be looking for another safe laner.
10 seconds.
Confusing stuff, I have to say, coming out from them.
5 seconds remaining.
What does Sherdils go for? They're clearly looking for a middle laner, right?
To go up versus... I think you want to hold on.
How do you feel about the Invoker for Sherdils? I mean, kafi stuns in their lineup. They have the Sven, Shadow Shaman and Nyx Assassin. Throwing down a Sunstrike on any one of these makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, there's a lot of setup. A lot of opportunities to land Sunstrikes which could result in kills. And the general control that the Invoker provides is going to be very useful mid-game and is going to force the Legion Commander and Phantom Assassin to desperately scramble for a BKB.
Yeah.
8 seconds remaining. Dyer's I'm not sure if they even considered Invoker. Or wanted that Invoker, but it seems as if your wish has been fulfilled. It's going to be the Invoker indeed.
I'm not a fan of the Invoker now because it seems like they've gotten a bit too greedy. Because there's still that early game potential and snowball potential that comes with the Legion and the Invoker. But Sherdils are in a position where they can deal with it if they play their cards right. Nyx is fantastic versus Silencer and the Invoker. Shadow Shaman, a hit or a miss, but some good control versus the Phantom Assassin. Doom, obviously, he's got plenty of targets to choose from here. I'd say the Phantom Assassin and the Invoker are his highest priorities. And Mamacita should be able to deal with Invincible on the middle lane as well. A one-on-one with a co-op versus Invoker tilts in the favor of whichever teams has the better support rotations.
I'm going to make a strange prediction here, but I think Crusaders have lost this. It's too early, but... And the reason I'm saying this is quite simple. Look, the Legion wants her blink. If you spend time in the lane, and it depends how the Legion plays this, it's going to take a while to get your blink coming. You're going to contest, but that it's not going to amount to much versus a spend. Until the Legion gets her blink, the Invoker is not going to be getting kills.
Five
and the Invoker,
seconds remaining.
I mean, he's not going to be bringing down the co-op anytime soon. Mamacita is going to be applying pressure on Invincible. All three cores need a bit of farm. The Legion needs her blink at the very least, and a lot of pressure is on the Legion to get that blink and set up kills for Invincible.
You've definitely pointed out a chink in their armor. The only way they can overcome that at this point is by getting phase boots on the Legion early on. Obviously, I'm assuming she's going to go for the phase boots. And then coupling up her movements along with the Earthshaker.
Right.
So theoretically, Fisher, while you're running up to the hero, get the duel off and follow it up with the Sunstrike. Yeah. Up until you get the blink back.
So what I've noticed is that a lot of Legion commanders, they have a lot of fun spamming overwhelming odds and contesting the lane. Mm-hmm. But then their blink comes by, say, the 16, 17, 18 minute mark, which is a little late. It's okay because you're getting it with phase, stake, poor man shield.
Sometimes it's worth it because you're then slowing down the enemy core as well.
You are, but you really are not going to be slowing down the Sven. It's unlikely. The Sven has cleave, there might be stacks as well.
Yeah.
If it's a weaker core, say an anti-mage, you should be applying the pressure early on. But I don't think a Legion can really slow down a Sven.
Yeah,
then Legion picks up a blink. They've already reached the 17, 18 minute mark. You might have already had a horrible laning phase. And now you at least have to find 5 kills in the next 10 minutes or so. 5 really crucial kills on cores. It's hard. I've just seen this momentum or this flow of the game with Legion commanders happen often.
It's also... So Legion as an offlaner has turned into a situational pick, right? You don't want to always go in with the Legion because, let's face it, the only reason she's great in the offlane is because A, she can go blow for blow versus the support that comes in to harass you, and B, she's got to press the attack to dispel negative debuffs.
Right.
So for example, if you've got something like a slow kick in on you, you shrug it off with the press the attack and run away.
Right.
In this case, you've got a reliable stun in the form of the Shadow Shaman hexing or coming in with the shackles, and you've got a reliable follow-up with the Nyx Assassin, To make matters worse for the Legion, there's a third stun in the form of Sven's cherry on top from that Stormhammer. If the Legion stays in the lane, she's gonna die.
Yeah.
There's no two ways about it. The only real thing that she can do is tag the overwhelming odds on the Shadow Shaman when he's next to another hero or if he's next to the creep
right. phase.
And that in itself would only happen if the Shadow Shaman makes mistakes.
Right, that's a hard ask, right? To expect the Shaman to be clumped up with creeps and Sven all the time.
Yeah.
I'd like to see...
In fact, this is the level 1 kill on the Legion if he's not careful.
Yeah, it is a level 1 kill. I hope Darshan gets a ward if he's hoping to go to lane. And if not, I hope Darshan just ditches the lane altogether and moves into the jungle. It's time for some good old cancerous SEA Legion. And if there ever was a game for one, I think this is it.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if he just aims for the Iron Talon right off the bat and ditches the lane. What's the possibility of an aggressive tri lane here from Crusaders?
Nah. From Crusaders?
I want to take that back right away.
It's not too strong.
Yeah.
I mean, if Sherdils wanted, they could run one. And give the Doom the safe lane, maybe get his early blink.
That's a possibility.
If Doom lanes versus
but,
Legion, sure.
Yeah, no, I think the Legion comes out on top.
Legion comes out on top for sure, but if the Doom has consumables, puts points into Scott's. I mean, he can survive. The Legion's going to win. You're going to give Legion a win, but you're going to contest the PA. Huh. And maybe Doom gets an early blink.
I don't think
Is the trade off worth it?
I don't think so, because their priority on the side of Sherdils should be to contest mid and the Legion. PA can be dealt with up until the point she gets her BKB on account of the absurd amount of magic damage they've got with the Queen of Pain and the amount of lockdowns they've got coming out.
Okay.
Even if you can't deal with him, as long as you shut the other sides, that's what your Doom is for. You delete a hero that you couldn't control in the early game, make sure that he or she doesn't have impact in the mid game of the team fights, and deal with the rest as a five-man unit.
I'd also like to point out that I'm not really a fan of the silencer pick. Everything is... I mean, they place all their eggs in one basket. They want the Legion to succeed. They want those duels to come off. And a lot of pressure early on to Darshan. But for now, let's start with a quick look through the lineups. Bakemono going to be playing the Phantom Assassin, Invincible. The new talent on the side of Crusaders going to be playing that Invoker. Darshan, the Drafter on the Legion Commander. TT going to be playing the Earthshaker. And that leaves us with Shenjin on the Silencer.
On the other side, it's going to be Queen of Pain, handled by Mamacita. Doom's going to be in the hands of Khans. Nyx Assassin in the hands of Disruption. Shadow Shaman will be played by Opa. And that puts Sven, courtesy, Rival. Did they swap things up? Was Rival their offlaner?
No, Khans is their offlaner.
I saw a brain fart moment right there. Anyway, Rival's going to be going in the safe lane then in his comfort spot. And we're not looking at any aggressive tri lanes just yet. I'm trying to think of the permutations and combinations here. Can Shenjin join Darshan on the top lane and add any value? That doesn't make too much sense, because then you've got two melees going up against what seems like it could be a Doom plus a Shadow Shaman.
Huh.
Maybe Opa's just here to help out in the early stages, assuming that someone's going to come in and contest.
Did Opa possibly just hand over a ward to the Doom? Is that it?
That could be it, yeah.
Okay. Khans has a ward. You know what, if the Doom runs a dual lane with the Shaman and sort of forces the Silencer to rotate to the safe lane, I'm pretty sure that Rival, along with the Nyx, could bring down the Legion Commander rather easily.
Mm-hmm.
It's possible, and you're also applying pressure early on onto the PA. The worst thing for you when you're a Phantom Assassin is to have no farm at the 10-12 minute mark. It's around the 14 minute mark that you want to pick up your Desolator. And what have I missed?
Khans could die at level 1 because of his greedy item build.
Yeah. It's one change to the shop that's pretty much altered the way offlaners are entering the offlane now. You can't buy the slippers of agility from the side shop. And Khans, I mean, he's already assuming that the new patch has rolled out and he's picked up two slippers of agility.
Cast off the lines.
No, I mean, you can pick up the Stout Sheen from the side.
You can pick up the Stout Sheen, but you can't pick up the slippers of agility from the side.
So he's walked out with two slippers and he hopes to get the PMS by the time the lane... the lane actually gets underway.
It's a sign of confidence.
The problem is their stuns, their slows. If he gets caught out with one well-placed Fisher, he's forced to put his first point into the Scorched Earth. He's forced to run away and then he can't even go into the jungle.
It's also interesting what the Phantom Assassin has done. Actually, there's a range creep push through in the bottom lane. Mid lane, you have Senjin hanging around, trying to secure Invincible a good start. The creep aggro absolutely messed up. Khan's, his range creep's gonna end up dying, so the wave might push in as well. And this is, okay, so Darshan gets his poor man shield. Did he get the bounty?
Yeah, I think, no, he didn't get the bounty.
Okay.
He's just using overwhelming odds to pick up a creep.
Opa, I'm not even sure why he showed himself in the lane like that. He could have just waited on either side of the offlane and possibly tried to loop around with the shackles and force Darshan out of the lane. A little sloppy support play, in my opinion.
Yeah. I don't even know if Senjin should be here, to be honest. I mean, sure, he's zoning out disruptions from coming in, but Mamacita is still going to be able to walk up and throw out the Shadow Strikes and do what he does to Invincible. 6-2 on the Queen of Pain. Not too much that Senjin has done apart from now force out a salve from Mamacita. And the creep wave still under Mamacita's tower. Anyway, Invincible has himself that extra bit of assurance that his ally is watching his back. Oh no, Mamacita, that's not what you want to be doing, man. He just let the Invoker walk up to him and cancel his salve. So now Invoker has the advantage in the matchup, and with that Fawn Spirit out there, he might even consider going up on Mamacita with a couple of hits, forcing out a blink.
Yeah, slightly sloppy play coming up from Mamacita. You gotta respect the attack range coming up from the Invoker and not get caught out like that. Darshan level 2. How is Khan's looking on the Doom?
Double damage.
Khan's is level 2 as well. Not doing too bad. They're trying to go
have
after.
A kill coming out here. They've got the stun. This is what we talked about, right? They'll just stun lock into death. But the PMSM's helped him stay alive. He pops a salve on the way out, along with the overwhelming odds to down to give him that movement speed.
Both offlaners barely end up escaping. They did try to move on to Khan's. Khan's didn't manage to complete the PMS. Also caught the shockwave stolen from the neutral camp.
That's the creepy walls. Yeah. More importantly for the Unholy Aura, 6 HP regen per second. It works wonders along with an enchanted mango, which by default gives you a 1 HP regen.
Yeah.
But then, of course, Doom with the Scorched Earth can regen up some more. This is now put him into a very comfortable zone on this bottom lane with the PMS plus ridiculous amounts of regen.
Mm-hmm. What's worth noting is that the Dial have done a much better job of controlling the creep equilibrium. Rival has a creep near his tower, while Khan's has a creep wave approaching him, so he's getting more out of his offlane. This has sort of forced Legion to move around aimlessly. Senjin and Bakemono applying a little bit of pressure. But like you mentioned, the Unholy Aura.
He doesn't care, man. He's at 9 HP regen without any consumers. Anyway, mid, there's a wraparound coming in. There, Mamacita jumps in. They whiff on the mid tail. And now Invincible has support coming in. Mamacita actually slinked in, so he's got to be careful. There is a curse available now. Not even necessary, because the Fisher will score first blood. DT and Senjin making the most of his ally being the bait.
So, if I'm not mistaken, Mamacita blinked in, but didn't blink onto the high ground, didn't blink onto the radiant high ground, so he didn't even have vision of the TP. And 2 points in Shadow Strike, and the whiffed impale because they didn't have enough to bring down Invincible. There were two TPs onto the mid lane. It was Senjin as well as the Earthshaker. One of those TPs took a lot of time, and even then they managed to bring down and punish Mamacita.
This is slowly getting out of hand for Mamacita now. He's having to commit blinks and shadow strikes onto Invincible in the lane, while Senjin is being zoned out by disruption. But Invincible is basically denying him under his tower because he's got two nulls and the exhaust damage kicking in. That's close to 100 physical attack damage that he's got going for him. Mamacita can no longer live in his space, and they know this. Khan comes in, he's diving under the tower with the Scorched Earth as well. Invincible will commit a cold snap and they'll do some work on Khan before backing away themselves. Mamacita.
Actually, top lane is Darshan, who's in trouble. Not sure if he has a TP to get out of there. Not too much mana, not too much HP either. He does have a TP, but he can't get out. Rival ended up missing the Stormhammer thanks to Fog. But look at that, so many units. Opa, what have you done?
He just played them like a fiddle there, going round and round around that bush. And
that shouldn't be happening.
Rival even consumed the mango for that, by the way.
That should have been a kill. That should have definitely been a kill.
Yeah, I mean, miscommunication coming out from both teams. One should have gone from one side, they should have gone in from three different angles to stop them. And they should have just held their ground. And the worst case he'd have TP'd out after a bit.
So Darshan is getting a lot more than he should out of his lane. Not in terms of farm, but he was bullying Rival on the Swen a bit. And he really shouldn't have been escaping that gank. I mean, if Khans did manage to take a look at the enemy offlaner and that gank that just narrowly whiffed, he's going to be a little pissed with his team.
Sitting at 1-0 in favor of Invincible and the Pokes.
Darshan giving chase the last word. Invincible silence.
Invincible nails him.
Sunstrike. Invincible reads him like a book and lands a sweet sunstrike to get the kill. Khan, though, he's got the HP regen, but Phantom Assassin has a fair amount of damage. The Scorched Earth, as well as a little bit of armor coming from the control neutral, he's going to ensure that Khan is going to barely survive, but TT, he's not going to get juked in the fog. He manages to get off the Enchant Totem, thereby cancelling the TP. Khan, low on HP, juking them left and right. TT and bakemono have no idea where he is, but now it seems that the jig is up, and Khan's corner surrounded and brought down. Bakemono gets the kill.
And this is how it's done. Not like what they
did.
He went from the neutral side of the field and ensured that he got stuck there. For some reason, Khan's even popped the mango, but top, they're gonna find Darshan, and this time he might go down. Nope, Darshan is out of there. Just lifting her skirt and running away, that Legion Commander.
Yeah, the press What's P attack this? Making all the difference. And if I'm not mistaken, he even has Shrine to work with.
This is one of those games where I would probably rage quit if I was playing on that top lane, man. Twice now, Darshan has escaped.
Yeah.
That should have been confirmed.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
This is the worst part, right? He's shrined up, he's going to come back into the lane, and he's just going to apply a little bit more pressure. He's also got the Blades of Attack. The lane's not going as expected for Rival.
He's got a lot more than he should have in this lane.
Yeah.
He's almost at level 6. There's some creeps coming under his tower. The supports have left the lane altogether as well. And it's not like they're accomplishing much elsewhere, because when they tried ganking Invincible, they actually ended up losing Mamacita.
I mean, I'm not opposed to the idea of them trying to gank Invincible, but I'd like to see them do this to the smoke. Mamacita this time blinks onto the high ground. The Fisher is perfect. Disruption taking too many hits from the tower. The gold snap as well. So he gets the spike carapace off, but he's lost his mid laner. Darshan with the rotation, with the overwhelming odds.
Notice what Crusaders are doing. The moment they jump in on Invincible, they change priorities so quickly. A Fisher to block out the Nyx, a Cold Snap on the Nyx, but they realize that the Queen has blinked and has nowhere to go. They change targets immediately. Nyx may have been the confirmed kill, but Mamacita is the more high priority kill.
Right. Good stuff. I mean, like you mentioned, Invincible, he just used the Cold Snap on the Nyx. Nyx was forced to run because the tower was attacking him. And Invincible had the presence of mind, along with the rest of his team, to just bring down the Queen of Pain. It's a rotation from Darshan, and if I'm not mistaken, it was Darshan who got the kill. So he's got that extra gold as well, and he's certainly getting to his face boots a lot quicker than expected. In fact, I think he already has it. Yeah, he's got the face boots up and running.
This is go time for him. The duel's gonna come online soon enough as well, and he's queued up a magic wand into a blink dagger. Not really stressing about getting that early blink dagger, especially when his team is doing so well for now. Eventually, he knows that if this game continues as is, he's gonna get some space to farm elsewhere, and that will give him his blink dagger. All he's gotta do is keep a TP and, yeah, go at this. When they pull to the side, he pulls back and takes whatever creeps he can along the way.
I'm not entirely 100% behind what Darshan did there. I mean, it's obvious when you see a lot of units to drop the overwhelming odds, but he's only reducing their HP for this man. And if Rival has taken note of this, he could come and contest the stack if he wants to. But
do agree with what Darshan is doing, to be honest. He's taking whatever money he can from the stack before the Sven decides to go for it. But this could prove to be very costly because disruption is coming in. All right, Sven knows what's up.
Yeah.
He cannot wait any longer.
I'm not sure that was necessary.
I think it was.
You think it was?
You don't risk
it. He has Warcry.
The Darshan's probably going to try for
a using echolocation.
Okay, fair enough. So Rival gets the stack. The majority of it at least. That's good. Bottom lane. Khan's last word. They're chasing the Fisher. Perfect from TET. Remstar confident of sitting this one out. The shackles are there. Khan's with the Doom onto the Phantom Assassin. He might end up going down. And he spoke of how the silencer gets smarter, but he's not yet going to secure the kill on Khan. Mamacita with the rotation. Khan with the duel. The Sonic Wave is there, but the duel most likely going to be won by Darshan. The Impale coming a bit too late. The Fisher warding them away. And Doom, as well as the Shaman, end up going down.
So Doom actually died to a Sunstrike. Invincible is just playing out of his mind this game. and his team is backing him up perfectly for
this. Dire's middle tower is under attack.
His team came out to help him, and he returned the favor at the bottom lane. Good kill on the Doom, good kill on the Shadow Shaman as well. Now, Shadow Shaman's here to redeem himself, gets the shackles off on Invincible, but what's the point?
What's the point? I mean,
he's out here by himself.
Radiant's top tower and if you take a look is on at the rocks. Network,
The PA is ahead by a huge margin. And what's worrisome is that Doshin on the leading commander has more net worth than the Queen of Pain.
Mamacita,
that was his first sunny wave, he'd be a bit displeased with the result. Oops.
He was aiming for Mamacita there with
yeah.
the
Nearly missed.
I don't think he'd have got
They're to trying kill. To bring down Radiant's
yeah,
top
actually,
tower.
Yeah. No shrine available, so that means that the Queen of Pain has to make a base trip.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Bakemono. Bindas palm kar rahe bottom lane. There's the nobody stopping him. He's just doing his thing. If someone comes in his face, he fights back. Mm-hmm. Khans also cannot stand in his face anymore because his armor is absolutely lacking. He chose not to pick up a ring of protection early, which means that the physical deep is going to hurt him. Dalshin. The overwhelming odds and the duel at the ready. And he's also got some backup coming in now. Senjin on the cover of the smoke. They really don't need too much firepower here either.
Yeah, the
problem is Invoker doesn't have the Sun Strike, so this kill might be a bit
can
harder.
Can Invoker run at the mana? Oh, the shackle on the Darshan. The Fisher is there, press the attack as well. The duel on the Lynx, they don't need the Sun Strike. They have the Echo Slap. The overwhelming odds on to Opa. Opa caught in between. This is painful to watch. Rival goes in, he wants to bring down the Earthshake, and with the rotation from Mamacita, might be able to. He didn't see Opa, otherwise that Enchant Totem hit would have definitely been reserved for the Shaman. The good news is, Darshan gets the duel victory, and he loses an Earthshake. I think he's absolutely fine with that.
Yeah, he's totally fine with that, man. And that kills, those kills would have been significantly easier. Well, there was a Sunstrike.
What?
Okay, that's where the Sunstrike was. He finds Shadow Shaman again.
How did Invincible do that? Is
that
a ward?
Yeah,
okay.
I've got a ward.
Shaman going to pick up a bounty rune.
That was greedy. Man.
That was greedy. 100 unreliable gold. I'm not sure that's worth it.
So, you know, to summarize, they got everything they wanted
yeah.
from that fight. They're completely fine with giving up an Earthshaker that's got Arcane and expended the Echo Slam in that fight.
Yeah, the Earthshaker's got 900 gold as well, so he's getting closer and closer to his Link. What I'd really like to see from Sherdil is to pop a smoke, but what's the key item that they're waiting for? Instead, it's the Crusaders.
No, it is the Sherdils around.
Oh, my bad. Apologies. So they have popped the smoke, but... How do they make this happen?
They hesitated for a moment. The smoke is wearing out.
Shaman
now,
needs to lead.
Around. I love what TT is doing. I feel like he's playing the best possible tier of Dota right now. He's reading them like a book. He is at the right place at the right time every single time, disrupting these ganks and turning them in his favor. He's playing out of his mind.
Shaman dropping low.
Bakemono, what are you doing? This is not how you do it. Okay, Opa's gonna die. The global silence is there. The press attack keeps him alive a little longer, but they get the return kill on Bakemono nonetheless. It may be completely worth it this time for Sherdils, because Bakemono just got trigger happy there.
Yeah.
What's the point if TT's gonna save your life and you're just gonna go throw it away then?
That was really unnecessary. I mean, that's called not respecting your opponent. And disruption.
Are scanning for enemies.
Trying to punish them a little bit more.
Radiant
he knows this thing could be used. Doshin is edging brilliant, so they're playing. He's tailing him, but Khans without the Doom doesn't feel
Mamacita
comfortable giving chase.
A little low on mana.
Yeah, I think you give this
Dyer's
the
tower
is still available.
Is under attack.
Could come in.
Yeah, and TTTPs as well.
He's close to his blink.
He's close to his blink as well. I mean, Crusaders, they've done really well for themselves in this early game. I'd just like to see them farm it out a little bit maybe, get their Blink Daggers on the Legion as well as the Earthshaker, and then it's their game to lose.
Bakemono, just gotta... I mean, this is one of those games where your captain says, calm down, Bakemono. We're not at that point where you can go nuts just yet, but I promise you, if you keep your cool, we'll make sure that you can.
So, what's... interesting to note is that Bakemono played the Enchantress
the
last
rocks.
Time around for the Crusaders. He was their fourth position, and with TT now in the roster, Bakemono well stepped into Remstar's shoes. He's playing the one position, and you got
Radiant's
TT playing the fourth position. And
yeah,
Rival does manage to get that tier one tower. Opa, 14 minutes in,
really
nowhere close to
Hunter.
His level 6. That is a cause for concern.
Radiant's top tower is on the
that's
rocks.
Costa, so he can't come back to the lane anymore unless he has a death wish. I like what Disruption is doing as well, just scouting out where Darshan is.
But Radiant's the call is very straightforward for Crusaders. They don't want to fight too much up until they get their blinks online, primarily on the Legion Commander and that Earth Shaker. The priority should be the Legion Blink, and then you've got the Blink Global Silence combo back in 8 seconds as well. So that's the game plan for them. Stay for the Blink and finish with the Global Silence. This seems like one of those games where Rival is getting fattened up, but the tandoori chicken analogy applies here as well, like in the previous game. Rival could just be a fat chicken who can be claimed and eaten by the side of the Crusaders. If he gets too much net worth on his belt, he dies, he gives it all up to his Crusaders. You don't want to give that Phantom Assassin a snowball's game either.
Yeah.
Another interesting thing about the Crusaders lineup is, so in a game like Dota, there are very few heroes or spells that give you permanent bonuses that last till the end of the game.
Nice.
Legion Commander's Duel is one of those. Every victory you gain is an extra bit of damage that you get right up until the end of the game. And it's the same with the Silencer. Every kill that happens in your vicinity gives you bonus intelligence, and with bonus intelligence comes mana and damage. Again, that stays till the end of the game. More importantly, you take away intelligence from the side of your opponent, which makes them weaker till the end of the game. The longer this game goes, the better it gets for Crusaders lineup, and they already had a good start as well.
Yeah.
I think not.
And they've also picked up the blink on Darshan, so I'm curious to see in which direction they're going to move towards to find their first pickup. Mamacita, despite the horrendous start he's had, he's found the whale, he's making some sort of progress towards the youth sector. Invincible, he's got the Midas, three out of four, actually.
The point boosters have been picked up.
Oh, the point boosters have been picked up, I missed that. He's got three out of four components for his Axe Scepter. The net worth advantage, not too much. And this is something that I've been noticing time and time again in this patch. And this is, well, one of the key things that differentiates Dota from Counter-Strike. Counter-Strike, it's all in the numbers, right? I mean, 16 rounds is 16 rounds. 9-3 is not the same in Dota.
Yeah, it's still not a clear-cut victory for Crusaders. Their lead is slowly being eroded because of the space at which the Sven farms.
Yeah. For all purposes, we have a reset here. And the Fisher, he took too wild, but took too long. The Global Silence is there. The Fisher to follow. Darshan coming in. He's got the blink. Who does he go for? Khans would be the ideal target. You don't want him to get the Doom off. They're just going to back away.
Yeah, discipline being shown by Crusaders. This time, bakemono didn't jump in. The Global was a defensive Global.
Yeah.
And someone in their ranks gave the call, don't go, stop. Let this go. Let the fight go. That was the right call, because now they're going to come back stronger for the next couple. And they've got the Legion Commander in the vicinity to start things for them.
He's got his Axe Scepter. 18 minutes in. Reasonably good timing. He's only going to scale harder and harder. It's going to be a while before this gun picks up his AKB.
Mamacita. He's going to blink up to the north and back to the low ground. That'll get him away from this. And Senjun, who's just hanging about next to him.
Dire are scanning for
enemies. We talked about how TT's been at the right place at the right time. I think Disruption deserves a lot of credit this game as well. He's been making the right rotations for the most part and always providing valuable intel for his team to take objectives. Seven was thrown down and TT's coming in. Lots of caution things as well. Invincible, he's in the right spot himself! The Echo Slam was there with the Meteor right on top of him, but the Doom's about to follow it up in the backup. Isn't coming in either. With the Earthshaker down, they're going to turn on Invoker, and Invoker will be deleted. Sherdils, bang their chest hard, walk forward, get two kills and take a tower.
Beautiful stuff coming up from Sherdils, and actually a small error on the part of Invincible and TT. There were only two TPs, there was only one TP that came in, that was the Invoker. And just the Invoker and the Earthshaker, it's a little unlikely that they can defend versus what is pretty much the entirety of Sherdils. They do not want to be fighting right now, not until the Invoker respawns. That's when I'd like to see Darshan going for the Doom. It's actually their turn to fight, if anything, because the Doom is on cooldown. Darshan
almost catches the Sven.
Bakemono, he's got that Desolator online. I'm pretty certain if that was a 5v5 with the Global Silence online, that fight would have been an absolute disaster for Sherdils. But they're picking and choosing their battles, fighting only when they know that they've been assured victory.
I'd actually like to see Crusaders pop a smoke now. They've got everyone alive. The Global Silence is online. Pop a smoke with some detection. Possibly Dust, in my opinion, Disruption. He has been getting them a lot of valuable information. Mamacita in the mid lane. But without Darshan, I don't think they're going to get the kills. no detection as of now for the next assassin. And Senjin almost sensed this.
That was a close shave. Disruption will bail because of it. And you can clearly see that the entirety of Crusaders is just grouping up now for fear of being picked off. But some smart wards, man. Disruption has been playing really well this game.
Yeah.
He is the next assassin. He may not be setting up the kills.
Global silence top lane. They're going in. It's actually a defensive global silence once again to keep it from alive. And he did manage to get the boost.
Radiant's bottom tower is
under attack. Darshan's coming in. They've got the Mune, the Sunstrike. Look at Sherdils Opa walking in to try and tank up as well. Khan's gonna end up dying, but it won't be a dual kill. Now disruption can't be discussed. They've got Darshan under the tower, but the rest of his scaffold is in the vicinity as well.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Radiant's bottom tower faces a stiff wind. But unfortunately,
Radiant's bottom tower has rung its last bell.
Once again, this shouldn't be allowed.
Dire's top tower needs some friends.
There we go. Arcade after the vendetta hit, looking for the Fisher, goes left, goes right, and hits nothing. He's walking around with so much intelligence this game, and they're just getting dumb up with every passing second.
Yeah.
Opa. Why on earth does a Shadow Shaman have Tranquil Boots?
I don't know.
It's not like he's swimming in mana to use all of his spells. The Serpent Wards scale exponentially. His items will not because he's a 5 position. He hasn't even put a single point into the hex. There's just so many questions that come to mind when I look at the Shadow Shaman.
Bakemono being tailed by the next monster. Indeed they will. The tornado is there, but Bakemono caught in the shackles.
No way.
He escaped from 5 heroes and Invincible is turning it around. Ice Wall on the ground. Khan pops the BKB. Excuse me, pops the Blade Mail. Wants to make a run for it elsewhere. Opa, he's been caught. And the Triangle Boots might not be enough with the shackles, so they might be able to bring down Darshan. The Sunstrike will whip Senjin as well as Darshan making a run for it. No lockdown just yet from the side of Sherdils. They're giving chase. In fact, they're just going to loop right back and take the tier 1 tower.
Radiant's middle tower just keeled over.
I took my Fedora boost. He basically went in and decided it's not the right time to use the pure deathly class. I'm only going to use the deathly class to help keep Bakemono alive.
Yeah.
Again, split second decision making. This is the mark of a solid team that says, Bakemono, blink on me. I'm going to keep them at bay while you blink out.
For all intents and purposes, I assume that Bakemono was dead, but Bakemono barely surviving by the skin of his teeth. And once again, Crusaders on the offensive. Time and time again, they're being punished for just not carrying detection from the Knicks. That's what's really hurting them the most.
The issue this time is that though, with the reset button hit, there's no global silence, but there is a doom available. Jacob. They got the point.
Beautiful stuff coming out from Sherdils. Unfortunately, Mocha, they DO in a team fight. I think it was once again a fight for the tornado as well as a deathing bomb. But he got the meteor.
They're trying to bring down Radiant's top tower.
And it's showing the chink in the rough.
Radiant's top tower.
If you already come to the guys, you've got two things to worry about. You've got the Shaman and his shackles. And you've got multiple things for lockdown. You need to defend. Also, the two. And you're just not getting any of the lockdown. You're depending too heavily on AD or Chaker.
Radiant's scanning for enemies.
The fighting itself was questionable.
From the Crusaders?
From Crusaders.
Okay.
Because you don't have the global silence. They didn't expend too much apart from the Serpent Wards in the last fight. Whereas you expended your global silence and Well, your Echo Slam isn't going to be a guaranteed kill.
On that note, let's take a small break because the fact that we park here is close. We'll keep watching Ucypher Mare Sports as it becomes
even worse.
To add insult to injury, they had a big dagger in this man. Yeah. Two minds long.
Dire's bottom tower won't last long.
Another crucial item to pick up is the halberd on the That's pretty much going to ensure that the Phantom Assassin or maybe even the Legion Commander who depend too heavily on physical damage won't be able to do too much without possibly producing DK. And then just depending on a huge Echo Slam and possibly the Invoker to do the heavy lifting in these team fights.
To recap what happened, he just dropped the Fisher, basically them off on the high ground, and then he blinked beyond this Fisher solo. The rest of his teammates were left scratching their head because Mamacita blinked in, the Legion Commander blinked in this direction to catch Mamacita, and then there was no follow-up on either side.
I mean, the Legion Commander blinked but didn't duel Mamacita. He ended up dueling the Sven, and Shaman got a full unit tackle off on the Earthshaker. The Meteor came out, but really didn't end up hitting anyone. And Crusaders, a lead that they fought quite hard to accrue, has been lost in the previous fight, and in Sherdils with the advantage, a 6,000 gold swing in their favor.
That one team fight. It transitioned into a tier 2, into a Roshan takedown, and the next time they come back, they're going to come back with these brand new shiny toys.
Yeah.
The next item choice for Rival, I think it should be either the MKB or the Bloodthorn here. I want to say the Bloodthorn, but...
Bloodthorn as well, but
problem is, he's going to have his DKB by the time the next fight breaks out in Bakemono. And you should have the Lincolns on this Invoker, but... I'm wondering why he chose to go Lincolns instead of Yules this game, because...
I think for the Doom.
Yeah, well, right, brain fart again, yeah, definitely the Lincolns.
I'd also like to see maybe the Earthshaker or the Silencer just give up the idea of any other item until they complete a Lotus Orb.
I mean, if the Silencer does that, he's... I don't even know what he does.
At least the Earthshaker. Someone should be considering a Lotus Orb. He's going for the 4-star, which is okay or good for him, but not great for his team. It might save a couple every now and then, might extend the range of the Shackles, but a Lotus Orb is so badly needed for them right now, especially when the Phantom Assassin hasn't yet completed a BKB. Either way, it's going to take a while. Invincible does have his Lincoln Spear, so he could drop it on possibly the Phantom Assassin or maybe even the Legion. Now it's going to be so crucial for the Crusaders to execute strats based around the Global Silence effectively. You want to do as much as possible before the Doom manages to get his Doom off, before Mamacita drops the Sonic Wave. And yeah, it's pretty much Rival's turn to shine in these fights with that brand new BKB as well as Aegis in his inventory. However, Sherdils is smoked up. Mamacita, he's got Sengen, only going to get poorer. The Fisher is there as well as the Tornadoes, the Sonic Strike as well. But Mamacita's done the deep damage. He's got the Silencer.
That was actually the Lich's blinking pass with the Blink Tag and Recon online. By the way, doing a lot of mana burst damage in the Silencer like we talked about earlier. And then the Silencer down for 18 seconds. No Global Silence means another Radiant Tower will be in the bag and hit at 80.
Radiant's middle tower has fallen
further. Or, you know, you can just deward everything and then come back for round 2.
So, they've taken down all tier 2 towers. And this is when every fight without buyback gets especially costly for the Crusaders. You die once, you don't have buyback, it's possibly a tier 3 if the Shaman or the Sven are still standing.
And
there are two ways the Crusaders could approach this. You either stay in your base and defend high ground, or you do something silly, try and take a risk, make a play on the back of the smoke. But that is really hard to do, especially when you have very limited vision outside your base. All they see is the river near the Roshan pit. That's pretty much all the vision that the Crusaders are working with.
Rival seems to be building defensively this game. He's queuing up the Assault Cuirass instead of what we thought would be either a Bloodthorn or an MKB.
I mean, it's good to some extent, right?
Yeah, you got the... I mean, okay, I can get behind that decision. You've got so much physical damage on the other side, you might as well.
I mean, primarily Invoker ka jump damage hai, magical hai, BKB Invoker se kafi protection deta hai, and then you've got the Assault Cuirass, which is going to protect you from the Phantom Assassin and the Legion.
Queen of Pain as well. She's getting pretty beefy.
Yeah,
here.
She did have the Linkits in the previous fight. Not sure what it protected her from. I think it was a Stifling Dagger. But yeah, it's come to that point where certain chinks in the draft of the Crusaders are starting to show.
And Crusaders are not doing anything, by the way. I mean,
yeah.
Up until now, it was fine because they had the Aegis on the other side. This wasn't the most efficient utilization of the Aegis from Rival and his teammates. But now that the Aegis has worn off, I would have expected any professional team and Crusaders as well to have taken down timing, knowing that the Aegis is no longer on him. Mm-hmm. And this is when they should pop a smoke and try and make something happen. Catch their opponents off guard while they've been essentially slacking. Look at this, man. Oh, this is Garden Gaming that's not being punished. Opa has gone for a stroll inside the Radiant Jungle by himself. And no one's doing anything about it. Invincible has just been juggling his balls in the middle of the game. And Darshan on the other side, he's farming neutrals where no one can see him. They're doing nothing. And because of that, you can see the draft just going in the absolute opportune direction.
So, this is once again the problem with the Legion Commander. I mean, you might assist in kills, but at the 31 minute mark, if you don't have a lot of dual victories to your name, I really don't know what the Legion Commander ends up doing. The duel as a spell is to some extent underwhelming, right? It's way...
I mean, Rival has almost as much dual damage as the Legion Commander.
Yeah, that one lost duel from the Legion Commander is really coming back to hurt her.
And that was a leveled up duel loss as well. So.
Yeah,
so
Darshan got 14.
So Darshan got two level 1 duel victories.
That's
and
it.
Then
and Sven got a
level
2
duel victory. So,
how many towers are intact as of now?
Mamacita's got the Yule, so he's going to shrug off the global silence. Has Khan's got anything of that nature?
Is that looking positive?
I mean, it's also very easy to itemize this in the global silence.
Khan's just BKB up. Yeah, I saw the green tab was up for him earlier.
Right. You guys are telling
of the situation being the way to go.
Yeah.
But change his mind. Remstar has
I see why. I mean, it's easier to build a BKB and waste the global silence rather than building a blink and hoping to jump onto the silencer. I mean, Senjin can right now just sit in base. If he wants to, he can sit in base and press a button for the rest of the game.
I mean, it's not like he's really adding value with these items elsewhere.
Yeah, and I don't know, but
really?
I have to ask Cloudx, do you think early on, sometime around the mid game, the lack of detection has come back to Earth?
It really has. I want to say that Disruption is the MVP, but I can't make up my mind about whether it was him or whether it was just the lack of detection on the side of the Radiant.
Yeah.
Guys,
they did have detection,
game
to be honest.
You guys,
but it's just that they were planting those wards too freely. And when it came time to take an objective, they didn't have any sentries to drop on the floor. I remember that one top fight early on with the tier 1. Disruption is just walking around 5 meters on the Vendetta, waiting for his arcane boost to cool down so he can start a fight. That's just disrespecting the Nyxus Hassan on the other side.
Yeah.
Anyway, with every passing moment, this Sven gets beefier.
Like
he's made progress towards the assault, and they have made up their mind. They want to wait for the assault before they want to fight.
I really don't blame them. I like.
Okay,
so Khan's has gone for the blink, but I really like what Sherdims are doing. Just by the way, the fact that Crusaders are sitting in their base, you're obviously going to accrue more network. You're going to come with items that the Crusaders cannot respond to. And you're almost going to force Crusaders to get impatient, pop a smoke and try and look for a pickup themselves. Maybe just counterplay. Look at that. It's only Legion who has some courage to push out. And thanks to all the deep observers and that Garden Gaming coming up from Opa on the Shaman, they know exactly where the Crusaders are. They popped a smoke, they're moving in the direction. Crusaders.
They actually made it to the next workshop.
Ah, okay.
Radiant's even gonna find these guys with a scan now, so they're gonna dodge the gank, but they may not be able to stop Rosh from dropping. Especially if they commit the Serpent Wards for Roshan, which is absolutely fine in my opinion.
This seems to be your motto, is it?
Darshan, a little far out. Disruption just walking up to him, blinks up in fact, has the impale. Rival will get the kill. And it's Sherdils working with a man advantage. Darshan might have to buy back if Sherdils just decide to march down the lane.
I think this is the wrong call.
You think go Roshan?
Yeah, the right call would have been immediately for Rival to swap up his TP into his stash. Everyone just moves to the side and goes in for the Rosh kill. That should have been the play here. Instead, they're trying to breach high ground when Rival's God Strength has worn out.
Yeah.
This is an opportunity for Crusaders to capitalize.
I agree. Hans, watch for that Doom. Invincible with the tornado. He's going to only manage to destroy bits of the creep wave.
He wants to take away Rival's mana, by the way.
Come on, Sherdils!
Rival still has a 10-second BKB, so... Yeah, it's a 10-second BKB. He has the assault
that was an absolute waste of time.
On behalf of Sherdils?
Yeah. They basically got a kill on the region, had no time in the back, but in a 4v5 matchup. Instead, they just got him. Now, you know that they're going to smoke it now.
Okay. Who's going to break the smoke? Do they have detection and disruption? That shouldn't be the key thing here.
No,
this shouldn't be happening. This shouldn't be happening. That was really silly of bakemono in the first place. The Fisher's there, Echoslam is well, if anything, can deck up the meteor, not really connecting on anyone. Rival pops in BKB, Earthshaker goes in, they've eliminated Opa, they've eliminated the Utos of Lockdown, and they might also manage to bring down Darshan for the side of Sherdils. Bakemono goes ham, he pops in BKB, but he can't man up to a Sven. Roshan's getting into the action as well, but TT gets a double kill with the Fisher, and he manages to retreat. Three fall on the side of the Crusaders, they're going for more. Mamacita, he does have the damage, does have a Yule Scepter, but the blade coming out from the Doom will cancel the TP. It's a dominating streak on the Queen of Pain. Four have fallen for the Crusaders, and Mamacita can move into the Rosh Pit.
Okay, the real criminal in that fight, I have to say, was the Legion Commander.
What did he do?
So, they played it perfect. He jumps in, gets the Echo, and then locks in the Sven over there.
Yeah.
Invincible even drops a Deafening Blast to push the Sven further behind while he was BKB'd up. The Legion said, okay, you know what, if you're all clicking on the Sven, I'm going to go jump in as well. So he blinked beyond the border into the Rosh Pit and duel the Sven, who was on Godspin, on a BKB, and on steroids for all I know.
Yeah.
He beat the hell out of him. I think he got another duel victory. No, he just got one duel victory in that game.
But the question is, where was Fantasy
This is a mistake that changed.
Hans wasted the cheese. He's used the cheese. Ages, I think Mama's is holding up to it.
No, that's what happened. They split first. They got a tier 3 after sacrificing the Knicks and their doom. That's not good. I don't think it's worth it at all. Look at the amount of gold they sent back. 2,000 gold. Even the cheese expended.
Yeah, Hans should have just held on and not committed the cheese. It wasn't going to result in him surviving. But yeah, Rival and Mamacita, they still have ages.
There really wasn't any hurry to go on high ground. All they had to do after the Rosh takedown was go back, wait till the Sven and everyone else respawns, and then come back with your Aegis and cheese.
Right. So, a tier 3 is crucial at times because it opens up shrines. But when Roshan is already taken down, there's no hurry to take down the shrine immediately. And getting this tier 3 and giving away 2,000 gold is really not worth it. Mamacita, though, he's trying to make amends. Senjin wants TP. Mamacita has a new scepter. He's playing with his food. And Senjin, he's not having fun. Caught by the Shadow Strike. Bought down by a couple of auto attacks. Mamacita on a mega kill streak. Invincible. He's had a quiet mid to late game. Hasn't done too much in terms of teamfight control or damage. Just going to let Mamacita blink away.
Silencer, at this point, shouldn't even be farming this far out. This is a big no-no. Mamacita sees it and punishes. No one comes in to back him up. Now, even though it's just a position bias that dies, Silencer, that's no global silence for 27 seconds, for 20 seconds.
So
everyone's under cover of the smoke.
Tell me what... No, they don't have detection.
Oh,
Rivals has an invis rune. And this is going to... I mean, if they watch his replays, they're going to be hitting for some time. Mamacita goes in, he has the agents and a little bit of license for YOLO, while Rival, with discipline, focus the baron. Master Pokemon's been committed, that glimpse for the is not going to do much. Invincible control, Khan goes in, he has the Doom, they didn't manage to prop that Lincoln's, and that means that Invincible is going to stand in base, muted as well. There's the duel, with the global silence, they should bring down disruption, and with Bakemono focusing him with that BKB, they'll get the kill. TT jumps in, but his backs have been taken away, Bakemono's BKB is wearing off, and Rival all this time gets a lane of Varix as well. Two lanes of Varix will fall. Mamacita will lose the Aegis, but in my opinion, Crusaders have lost the fight. Mamacita though controlled. The Echo Stunt committed. He really hates the speed of pain a lot, and they'll take away a Mega Kill streak. Crusaders find some consolation, but it's Sherdils here who are the real victors. Two lanes of Varix, a 21,000 net worth lead, and a smiley face. What a sad face.
Radiant's courier just by grounded none other than Cloud X.
And they get the courier now. Rival is just not letting him take anything this game, man.
So I really have to ask you this, and this has pretty much been the one line of this game. Can you explain what detection is to our viewers?
If I have to explain what detection is to Crusaders...
No, to our viewers. To our viewers. To our new viewers who are less acquainted with the game.
So, the concept of invisibility in Dota, and the only way you see an invisible hero is by having something called True Sight.
Right.
True Sight is...
What helps you see Mr. India?
True. It's basically those fancy glasses that show you what this is. India is. Which I later learned were just glasses.
Dire's middle tower is under pressure.
But they're cheap. And they're unlimited.
Just like Sentry Wards, which does the exact same function.
Yeah.
Dire's middle tower is drowning.
Sentry Wards, dust, and a gem. These are the items you can purchase for incrementally more expensive prices.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Dire's middle tower has fallen.
I mean, even now it's only TT holding on to dust. You do need sentries when you're up against the Knicks because, I mean, this is really surprising. And if you take a look at Remstar, he's pacing behind his team. He's a little disappointed at the lackluster performance today.
He's gonna be worried, but I'm sure as captain, his job at this point is to basically say, guys, don't give up. It's not over till the fat lady sings.
It isn't. I mean, the Crusaders pushed, they got a tier 2 tower. There's still 2 tier 2 towers and 1 tier 1 tower that stands in the off lane.
Oh, man.
Or
again.
Disruption.
Again. This is a movie we've seen before, haven't we?
So he's got one sentry, but Disruption has a use. He's going to set up the Impale and Rival. Well, he didn't pop the Godsend. He had the Master Madness. He secures the kill. That's CT down to 49 seconds. He might have to buy back Invincible. He's delaying the push, but he can't delay the inevitable. Once again, Crusaders being punished for not carrying detection. How do you make this crucial error? TP buys back, and a dieback on him could pretty much spell the end of the game. But they're going to be a little disciplined. They're going to fall back, destroy the shrine. And this is quite crucial, actually, because when you're pushing the top lane, a shrine is another access point for the Radiant. They could TP onto the shrine, but Sherdils, they're aware of this. They're going to bring down the shrine. And you know what's funny? While talking to Ritz earlier on today, he was extremely confident that the Sherdils would win.
I know. I mean, I was a little skeptical about his confidence, but man, is it paying off?
Look at him. That was a good time. And Ritz was right. The Sherdils, they're inching closer and closer to victory here.
No doubt. Well, I'm wondering if Rival wants to drop that Mask of Madness and pick up his MKB at this point, because if the MKB comes online, it essentially means the Phantom Assassin is sitting up for him as well.
Yeah.
Problem is, you sacrifice a little bit of attack speed with the Mask of Madness
gone.
I think at this point it's a fair trade. The Mask of Madness is only going to hurt you a bit more.
I mean,
honestly, he's not even playing versus heroes. He's just beating up on buildings while his team takes care of the heroes in this game.
I mean, the bottom lane Disruption was just a distraction while Rivals took another lane of Barracks. They didn't even end up catching it. So he's got the MKB complete. Mamacita's got the Maelstrom along with the Shiver's Guard.
It's also difficult for Crusaders to hold because Invincible hasn't hit level 25 yet. When he hits level 25, he gets that level, that 18-second tornado cooldown reduction, which means you can keep the creep wave out at every given point of time. As of now, though, he does have two waves pushing in from the one from the bottom and one from the mid consistently because he's lost his barracks on the middle lane.
Yeah, Mamacita's also hit level 25, so I think she's gone for the spell lifesteal talent, which probably explains the Maelstrom pickup.
Yeah. No one goes for the AoE Shadow Strike. That's just silly. I mean, Shadow Strike is. It's got diminishing returns as the game goes on, so you probably don't want to go for the upgrade on that spell. I'm willing to bet that's going to be reworked in the next patch. I would hope that Valve has data that says, okay, X amount of players are actually picking this talent up. It's a skill bracket, right?
And I'm not joking, I fall under that X.
You pick the AoE Shadow Strike?
It's fun. I mean, 60% spell life steal is
technically...
Remind
me to never queue with you again.
No, it's too good to pass on. I think that's a great talent, but I like the AoE Shadow Strike. It's actually a little irritating to play against. I mean, come on, it's gimmicky. If three arrows can become a thing, one day AoE Shadow Strike will.
I mean, if it had like 1,000 AoE, sure, why not?
It's got reasonable AoE,
actually.
It's
got 550.
Yeah, it's like, how do I put this? It's like a little... Like a kinetic field. What are you looking at?
I'm looking at Shadow Shaman's attack rate. It's a little less than Shadow Shaman's
attack. Yeah, it's like a kinetic field. It's roughly that much. Somewhere close.
Anyway.
I mean, it's unlikely that you're going to get it off on all five, though. That's why it's...
Unless you decide to have a Magnus on your team who breaks in and RPs everyone.
Yeah.
It's so silly, man. It makes no sense to skill that up. What's Sven gone for? 60? Of course he's gone for the damage talent.
Yeah, I think...
I don't think he has enough.
I don't think people would ever go for the Stormhammer reduction cooldown.
That's true. It's not like he has a lot of mana
to work
with.
So, what is Stormhammer's cooldown? Can you take a look?
30.
So,
minus 8 seconds.
Are you really going to get the opportunity to work with that cooldown in team fights and make such an impact? I don't know.
Somebody's... I don't think, if you're going to spam out a Stormhammer every 5 seconds, I don't think you're going to have enough mana.
You
have 140 mana on the Stormhammer and his total mana pool is 60.
So did Ice Frog somewhere and Sven is played as some form of utility?
Yeah, I think there must be like a space carved out for the Sven in some alternate dimension where he's played as a support, because I haven't seen that ever. At least not up until now. Anyway, Rival and Disruption. They've played it so safe, man. They've made mistakes in the past where they don't pick up the Aegis and go high ground. He's gonna wait it out, you know, ride the wave, take this Aegis and then go up. But desperation smoke comes out here from Crusaders. If they can defend this, who knows if they can turn this around. Khan's, oh, again! Where's the detection?
When
you need it, but the linkage was there. It triggered the Doom. The Doom, well, okay, he hasn't actually popped the Doom.
He popped his BKB and immediately ran out of there. Smoke wasted, Bakemono's BKB wasted, and
there's
all can go in. There's the Doom, the Infernal Blade onto another Dashin, got out of position, worked out, and buys back in haste. They're chasing down the PA. Khans throws a rock on his face, and Mamacita joins the fray. A EMP on the floor, but Bakemono is dead. He buys back as well, rival with the MKB, pounding away on the PA, brings him down. There's the Storm Hammer, and Echo Slam. It's huge. Bakemono buys back, he manages to bring down the next, but he will fall. It's a rampage for rival. He's made them die multiple times. Buybacks have been expended, barracks have been brought down, and Invincible can only watch while his base is under attack. The Halberd will control Invincible. It's the double G's called out from the Crusaders and the Sherdils. Well, with the Hearts of Lions, stroll in victory.
The Sherdils do manage to win in a rather convincing fashion. Dashin was there with the duel, but it wasn't enough for the Crusaders today.